children's pastor in my home has told me very often that God gives us the ingredients, but we must make the curry. And therefore, it is good to put a name for the curry, because if you want devil pork, you might just end up with sweet and sour, unless you name the curry that you're going to make. And there seems to be so many things that we are told today that we must do for children. The Word of God tells us a few things, quite a few. The psychologists tell us a few other things. The educationists say a few more things. And then when you look at all of them, you see the burden of parenting and you wonder, where do I start? And when do I say I've done it? When do I really say? So I want to name this curry with the name of a gift and call it the gift of blessing. The gift of blessing. And if you ever wonder what you are supposed to impart to your children at the end of your day with them, you are to impart to them a blessing. And impart to them a blessing. In the Old Testament, you see that there was a blessing that was passed from generation to generation. From Abraham to Isaac and Isaac to Jacob. Esau missing out. But when Esau missed out that blessing, you see a desperate Esau almost crying out and say, "Father, but don't you have even one little bit of blessing left for me? Don't you have anything for me?" And when the next generation loses out, there is an insatiable cry that goes on in their lives. Now I know that today I'm speaking to children and parents primarily, but this could be to anyone in your life whom God has given you a shepherding role. You might be a boss. You might be an uncle or an aunt. You might be a mentor. You might be a ministry leader. But you know what? There are people in our lives who need unconditional love and unconditional acceptance. And everyone in our lives, all of us, need at least one or a few people who give us that unconditional love and unconditional acceptance. And therefore, while I speak about the parental relationship today, I think we can extrapolate it, we can take it and put it to various other situations where you are a mentor, where you're a coach, where you are a boss, maybe a neighbor, maybe just a good uncle to a kid who's in trouble. People who don't receive a blessing cry out in many ways. And one of the ways they cry out is that, you know, the Word of God says that when you get married and when you form a new family, that you are to leave your father and mother and you are to start a new unit. And children who, and this is coming from research, it's not my research, it's well researched, and I'm presenting it to you, and you seem to see it all around you, that the new couple are unable to break away from the parental grip and to start their own unit, because there seems to be that constant need. I need my parents' blessing still. I need my parents' blessing. Sometimes it happens in ways where nothing is good enough. One more thing is needed. One more million is needed. One more home is needed. Maybe one more whatever is needed. And there's an insatiable appetite, because everything you have is satisfying, but only to an extent, because there's a cry within you. They say that workaholics who tend to constantly work but never rest, thinking that they have made it, are often people who have not have that parental blessing. You know, our kidney is important and our heart is important and our lungs are important. And when our kidney and our heart and our lung malfunctions, there are things that don't quite work out. And it looks like when we haven't really had a parental blessing. Now again, I want to tell you, if you're in Christ, the Divine Father is there with you. But then we have to do something with the goodness that God has given us for the next generation. And when the acceptance is not there, people easily tend to go towards withdrawal from society. Withdrawal and it also says that often it shows itself in unnatural sexual behavior. searching for something that they never had, looking for something. Sometimes it is the constant need to hang out. You know, when we were young, I'm sure the terminology has changed. Our group of friends were called our vala. And it's a constant need to be in a vala. Now, it's good to have a vala. But when you are there 13, 14, 15 hours. And honestly, my friend, I want to tell you, I have gone from home for practices in school and for my good. I had a motorbike. And sometimes I have gone and picked up my friends from the Shalika grounds and taken them for practices for rugby and for rowing. And because they have never gone home that night, they've stuck there, they've done various other things, slept there, and in the morning they've come up and taken with them. And that need where the home is not where the blessing is, home is not where the belonging is, home is not where the acceptance is. So what is the blessing? What is the blessing? And we want to read Genesis chapter 27, verses 25 to 29. There are six elements here, and we want to take that and look at them very quickly. Genesis 27, 25 to 29.
Then he said, "My son, bring me some of your game to eat, so that I may give you my blessing." Jacob brought it to him, and he ate, and he brought some wine, and he drank. Then his father Isaac said to him, "Come here, my son, and kiss me." So he went to him and kissed him. When Isaac caught the smell of his clothes, he blessed him and said, "Ah, the smell of my son is like the smell of a field that the Lord has blessed. May God give you heaven's dew and earth's richness, an abundance of grain and new wine. May nations serve you and peoples bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers, and may the sons of your mother bow down to you. May those who curse you be cursed, and those who bless you be blessed."
Isaac is calling and saying, "Come give me a hug, come give me a kiss." And this is not a 14-year-old, it's a 40-year-old. It's a 40-year-old, it's a 40-year-old man. He knows the ways of the world a little. He's been asked to go and bring a sacrifice or bring something to eat, and he's trusted with it. And to that 40-year-old man, Isaac says, "Come." And when he gets near, he gets the whiff of his smell. He gets that whiff. Ah, yes. I don't know what that whiff was, but he recognized it. That belonged to my son. And he had been close enough to him all that time that when he came close by, he tries to, "Oh, yeah, 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 this is my son." And obviously the clothes have been changed, for Esau's clothes have been changed into, Jacob is wearing them. And he's close enough. He's used to the touch of his child. And the first one that I want to tell you is, your blessing requires a meaningful touch. It doesn't amaze me that God intended, God designed children to be nourished from their mother's breast. It could have been the small finger, right? So you can have your child like this, the milk coming out from there, and walk along with him. But it was this hug. It was this closeness. Out of all the things that God could have done with his creative ability, he wanted the child to be hugged. Close. Because the child needed it. So mothers generally do touch their children in a nurturing way. Oh, but the macho man. Oh, but the macho man. And I know this is true for mothers, but men, I want to tell you that your child needs your hug. And he just might be 40 years old. He just might be 40 years old. You look at the life of Jesus in Mark 1, 40 to 42. And there's a leper. And the leper cries out to Jesus and said, "If you could you make me whole?" And Jesus basically, it's interesting to read that. Can we, is it available? Is there with you? No? And I'll read that for you. It says, "A man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees, 'If you are willing, you can make me clean.' Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and touched the man. 'I am willing,' he said, 'be clean.' Immediately, the leprosy left him as he was cleansed." So you know what happened is, a leper came to Jesus and a leper is not to be touched. So Jesus healed him and then touched him. Is that what the Bible says? He was with leprosy and Jesus touched him and then healed him. Touched him. And so often we feel that our children are not worthy of our hug, of maybe of an embrace, maybe of an arm around a shoulder, because there is some sort of insufficiency in them, or some sort of something that's wrong with them. And we see the example of Jesus here, that first he touched him and then he healed him. And for all of us who go through the issues of life, through work, through various things, I know that there is a job description we have, but there is a larger job description that God has given you and me. Now, let me explain this, that you are to touch the people around you. Now, today, touch is pretty dangerous because of all the things that are happening. As a pastor, I find myself very touchy. And once in a way, my dear wife has assured me and said, you don't mean anything, but be careful. And I am careful. But there is a touch that is non-sexual. There is a touch which is affirming. There is a touch which is acceptance, which is assuring. And God wants you to have that. Even as you go through the affairs of life, as you go through the healing work, whatever that you're doing, that you would touch. And Jesus thought it might be more important to touch and then to heal. And this man who had not been touched by a human being for a long, 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 long time, for the first time after a long time, is touched by God. You know, it says that our body has 5 million receptors. And that 1/3 of them is in our hands. And a good way to think of our hands and think of our skin is like a touch screen. You know, when you put your hand on a touch screen, information comes. And whenever we touch someone with our hands, information comes up, knowledge comes up, awareness comes up, acceptance comes up, because God has made our hand and people's skin a touch screen. And as you do that in the proper way, now I must also warn this. Please don't touch people in the wrong way. They know it immediately. Children don't need to be taught what the wrong touch is. They just sense it. And God says that if anyone stumbles a child, that nothing but a millstone, nothing but a gravestone around his neck. And I think we should take good note of this. There are benefits from touching, just physically. They say that if you take a immaturely born baby who's in the incubator and that you just feel that baby for 5 minutes a day, that underweight and all, just by that touch, that baby will put on 45 grams per day. It's unbelievable. And yet, we are the ambassadors of God. And God has given us children more than anybody else that we might touch. And wives, please teach your husbands how to touch their daughters in a non-sexual way. In a way it affirms them, it encourages them, and tells them who they are. Second point is feeling put into words. You see that. You see Jacob having feelings, the intentions of the father put into words. Words are powerful in people's lives. You see that God created the world with words. He did not create the goldfish in a incubator. He did not create the goldfish in a laboratory. He created the goldfish by speaking a word. And as you speak that word, there are things that are formed into our children's, into our people's, into our mentees' lives. But we can also speak the wrong word. And I remember one day I was driving down Park Road. I remember it very clearly. My air conditioner wasn't working, I think, that day. The shutter was down. And I saw two parents walking down. And they were having an obvious fight. And then halfway through, you know, like we know, the mother left and put this dance kind of walk forward. Turned back and said to the child, "Mem musalaya hinda tamai." And my heart just sank. It just sank. Why should that child be called cursed? Because the parents are fighting. And yet our society does that in so many ways. In so many ways. And our words are supposed to be life-giving. So when we look at Proverbs 18:21, it says this.
The tongue can bring death or life. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences.
The tongue can bring death or life. And we have to choose. We have to choose. And Proverbs 3:27-28 says this as well. It says, do not withhold good from those to whom it is due. When it is in your power to act, do not say to your neighbor, come back tomorrow and I will give it to you when you already have it with you. Do not withhold good that you can do today. Do it. And friends, today we can do good by speaking words of promise into the people around us. Into our children very specially. And God is calling upon that. I was listening to a lady who was talking about her children. And she said some pretty drastic things. Well, she started by saying that, you know, my husband and I are together because of the children. Because none of us wanted their custody. And then she says, when my son was 10 years old, he was just the sweetest child. But he's 14 years old and he's this guy with an attitude now. Huh? And then there's this day where I'm having a constant fight with him. And then he comes and asks me and says, if you are so upset with me, why did you have him? Have me? And I told him, I didn't know it was going to be you. And then talking about the daughter, she says, my daughter went to college and came back with a safety pin on her eyebrow. Now, I can identify with that. And she said, I didn't know eyebrows can fall apart in college. Then she says, now my daughter has a boyfriend. Before that, she says, you know, my children are not the smartest, not the fastest crackers, fastest on the field. I said, my daughter has a boyfriend, and she thinks fiancé and financed are spelt both the same. And then she says, my son, he thinks God's name is Howard. Because we pray, our Father who art in heaven, Howard be your name. And then she says, you know, it's my fault. When he was small, I told him, you won't amount to nothing. And he didn't. This was a comic. We don't want to be comics in our families. We want to be God's ambassadors in our families. We want to be God's hand extended in our families. And I think that's God's calling upon you and me. So see, we are called to express high value. And Jesus did this. He looked at Peter. And Peter was the most unstable, the most passionate, but the most unstable. And said, Peter, you are going to be called that little rock, Cephas, that stone. You're going to be used by me in solid ways. And when Peter was going to be tempted, he said, Satan has tried to sift you, but I have prayed for you. And there's this high value. Hebrews 10:24.
Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works.
Let us therefore consider. You know, love requires consideration. Love requires planning. Love is not just intentional, emotional, and immediately say it and feel it. Love requires something a little bit more. It requires planning. It requires for you to move ahead with something. And therefore, point D is we are supposed to picture a special future for our children. The Word of God is amazing. The Hebrew language is a picture of is a word, is a picture language, and often they use pictures to show. And in so many ways, it's interesting to see Genesis 49. Jacob receives a blessing, and now Jacob is about to die, and Jacob gives his children a blessing, and for each of them he has a different blessing, and for each of them, and I'll come to that later as well, but to each of them there is this picture that he prays. And at this point in time, he says that, "Ah, the smell of my son is like the smell of a field," in 27:27-29, "that the Lord has blessed. May God give you heaven's dew and earth's richness." What is heaven's dew and what is earth's richness? It's a picture of what God will do to you, my son. So don't go hither and thither. Don't go here and there. There is a God who cares for you, and he will give you. And he gives a picture to Asher. In that particular chapter, he says, "Asher, your food is tasty, and you're going to you know, lay the table that kings and queens will come and eat." And there's a picture. He knows Asher can cook, and he says, "Asher, because you can cook, I want to tell you, let nobody put your foot down. You can do this, my son. You can be a good chef, and you're going to, royalty is going to come and eat." And when Asher goes to work, and there is competition there, and there are things that are happening there which are difficult for Asher to measure up to, Asher remembers his father's voice. And says, you tell me my food is not good, but my father tells me that my food is good enough for royalty. And I'd rather believe my father than you." You know, Romans 12, 1 to 3 says, it tells us to measure up because of the mercies of God. And I think when we picture a good future for our children, they are given the chance to measure up. Rather than be looking down. When we give that to those whom we are discipling, when we give that to others around us as bosses, we do an amazing favor. You know, God is calling us to smell our children out. They have a particular smell. Go home and take a good whiff. They have a particular smell. And some of them are good mechanical guys who can do things with their hands. And some of them are going to be creative in other ways. Some of them are good mathematicians. Be close to them. Smell them out and see how is God wiring them. You know, we had a family here. They're no longer here. The wonderful girl, she used to sing specials here. She loved chemistry. She loved science. She loved to go and the father was an accountant, top accountant. And the father insisted that she does accounts. She qualified SEMA with flying colors. She did her chartered with flying colors. She finished both of them, went back home and stayed home and did nothing. And when I asked her why, she said, "I can study, I can do this, I can pass, but I hate accounts. Number crunching does not fire me up. Number crunching, what fires me up is the laboratory, is the mixing of chemicals, is the dissecting of things. And I can't do that, and I can't do this number crunching. I come back home with a headache, and I'd rather just stay at home." What a tremendous waste of potential. You know, I know that when we were growing up, there were only two streams. So we had at St. Thomas's, at least, the science block. And the other block was called the ice block. Because if you did science, you did chemistry, physics, mathematics, you were there. All the teachers came from, and you know, so from that we can see the other guys. Guys are with their hand, legs up, ice block. Nothing happens there. But guess what? I know some of the guys in ice block now. And they're doing tremendously well with the ice that they learned or didn't learn. Because God had wired them for something special. And they found it out. They excelled. And my friend, I think this is what you call sometimes a prophecy over your child. A prophecy is not only when you say, "Thus says the Lord," shake the child up, and all sorts of feelings come along. Prophecy is when you understand the future that God has for your child, and you prophesy over that child. And you prophesy over that child. And parents, today, God is calling you to prophesy over your child. Prophesy over him. Prophesy over him, not to curse him, but to understand, to feel, to pray, and to find out what God has in store for him. I'm going to give you the next two points and then just move on. Point E is to have an active commitment. Don't just say it. Work it through with them. Walk with them. Jog with them. Study it through with them. Have an active commitment. And point number F is imparting insight, guidance, and discipline. Discipline is a part of love. So to Reuben, Jacob says, Reuben, you are the first. But you climbed into your father's bed. You climbed into your father's bed. And Reuben, you better watch out. You've got a dysfunction in your personality. If you don't take heart and look at it, you're going to mess your life up. And parents, I want to tell you, love is not only soft. Discipline is love. Now, we might have to learn how to properly discipline. Discipline is training. It's not just scolding. It's not just punishing. Discipline is apprenticeship. It's training. And children, discipline is suffering. But it's good suffering. It's good suffering. A lot of videos have been going around with about Billy Graham. I found one that was extremely challenging and extremely inspiring. And I just want to close with that and invite the Spirit of God to take control of our activities of parenting, of guiding, of bossing people around, if I might call it, that this might be in our heart.
After 21 years, my marriage ended in divorce. I was devastated. I floundered. I did a lot wrong. The rug was pulled out from under me. My family thought it'd be a good idea for me to move away, to get a fresh start somewhere else. So I decided to live near my older sister and her family and near a good church. The pastor of that church introduced me to a handsome widower, and we began to date fast and furiously. My children didn't like him, but I thought, you know, they were almost grown. They didn't know what they could, they couldn't tell me what to do. I knew what was best for my life. My mother called me from Seattle. My father called me from Tokyo. They said, honey, why don't you slow down? Let us wait to get to know this man. They had never been a single parent. They had never been divorced. What did they know? So being stubborn, willful, and sinful, I married this man on New Year's Eve. And within 24 hours, I knew I'd made a terrible mistake. After 5 weeks, I fled. I was afraid of him. What was I going to do? I wanted to go talk to my mother and my father. It was a 2-day drive. Questions swirled in my mind. What was I going to say to Daddy? What was I going to say to Mother? What was I going to say to my children? I'd been such a failure. What were they going to say to me? We're tired of fooling with you. We told you not to do it. You've embarrassed us. And let me tell you, you women will understand you don't want to embarrass your father. You really don't want to embarrass Billy Graham. And many of you know that we live on the side of a mountain. And as I wound myself up the mountain, I rounded the last bend in my father's driveway, and my father was standing there waiting for me. As I got out of the car, he wrapped his arms around me and he said, "Welcome home." There was no shame, there was no blame, there was no condemnation, just unconditional love. And you know, my father was not God, but he showed me what God was like that day.